In today's video, we're going to go through three top things that have helped our running for Hyrox.
We're actually doing it from a coffee shop today, so anything can happen.
Mixing it up.
Doing different areas, because we just want to try different things, don't we?
Yeah.
We're sick of doing it in our house. We're going to do some in the gym, and then we thought we'd do a coffee shop today.
So, number one of the things we've incorporated a lot more of is doing longer, slower runs. So, a lot of you will know this as zone two runs. So, what we're going to cover a little bit in this is what those runs are like, how to tell if you're in zone two, and a few other bits. So, the longer runs that we've been doing, call them, where do we start?
Well, it was hell. So, I don't like running, and a lot of people don't like running. Where do we start?
Running's grown on me.
We are now. I hated it at the beginning. So I started around June 2022 when I started on a kilometre. You were injured and then we progressed from there. And I remember it took us months and months just to do 12 kilometres because we didn't really focus on running like we do now. And I think that's why our Hyrox's times have improved.
Yeah, so the longer runs we did, I think I started off by trying to do a couple of K on the treadmill and then built up to five. And then last weekend, we've done 20 kilometres before, we could definitely do more. And it's just getting more comfortable with it. And the way you'll get more comfortable with it is by doing it. Mm. And just be gradual with how you build it up. Yeah. So you don't want to be building your running up distance-wise by any more than 10% a week. And even that, I think, can be quite a lot. So just steady with any improvements. The main thing with all of your training is consistency and not to get injured. So how do you tell if you're in zone two? And it's really, really simple. The best way to do it is lactate testings. That isn't really, really simple. We're not even going to talk about that. If you want to know about lactate testings for setting your training, Google it, look it on YouTube. There's loads on there and it's quite complicated. You'll have to go and get it tested. So the really easy way to do it is, how to tell if you're in zone two is, can you talk while you're running, and is it uncomfortable to do so? The way to be able to tell as well is if you're on the phone to somebody, the person on the other end of the phone should know you're exercising. It shouldn't be as easy as we're talking now.
No.
It should be a bit of a struggle to talk.
A bit breathy.
But you can talk.
We did a longer run yesterday, and it was the first run I've done in a long time where we literally talked from start to finish.
Yeah.
And it was actually all right. So best, and we... Someone walked past us as we were running. They said, can't believe how much you're talking while running. We said this, didn't we?
Yeah.
We used to think we'd never be able to talk while running. That helps with your breathing in a way.
Yeah, well, we'd seen other people doing it and thinking, how are they just running? And
chatting.
Are they not putting in any effort or are they just that fit? And really, it's just come with time and also...
A lot of time.
Also feeling comfortable running at a slower pace.
Yeah.
Rather than thinking, oh, I need to do more, I need to be faster, I need to be quicker than last week.
Yeah.
Really that training, when you're building up the volume of it, over time you're going to want to get a bit quicker at doing what you're doing. But that's going to just come with fitness, and that does come over time. So that is really being patient with those runs and getting to a point where you actually enjoy them.
Yeah, I know.
I think is a big part of it. So you're not thinking,
I tell myself I enjoy it now. I had to tell myself...
Yeah.
And then the fact we can chat and run makes it a little bit easier. The thought of doing like an hour and 40 run or an hour and 30 on a weekend.
Yeah, but before
we've got to be willing to do
we'd start off at an hour and then at the end of the hour we'd stop and be like, oh, my legs are seized up, it feels really hard. Whereas yesterday we did 17 kilometres? Okay, when I stopped running, my legs still seized up. But I didn't have the pain in my hips where I'd felt like I'd done a really long run. So it's just consistency with it, and that's now our Saturday thing, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
We'll just get out and do
losers.
just get out and do a longer run. So to build up your running for Hyrox, even though you might be thinking, yeah, but Hyrox, you're just running a kilometre. You are, but you're continuously exercising for the whole of it.
Yeah.
So the long runs are going to have a carryover for everything that you are doing in Hyrox.
Yeah.
So number one, start building up your long runs. Also, make sure you're wearing the right trainers. Make sure you don't rush the process.
Yeah.
Anything else? Any other tips on long runs?
Yeah, I could tell you about our trainer changes, injury. If you need any help on it, comment below. But we've done it all, so we won't go into that. That longer runs is probably my favourite out of the other two that we've done. So let's go to number two.
So number two is going to be running at threshold. And if you look up what threshold in, different people class it as different things. You can have 30-minute threshold, you can have 45-minute threshold.
You love it, don't you?
I don't love it.
Yeah, you do.
But it's one where you're going to push yourself. You need to sit at that heart rate. And it's the same with the zone two stuff. Once you've done it a bit, you can then get an idea of what your heart rate is. So then you can use that. Same with this one. So this one, when you're going to do these runs, it's going to be as hard as you can work for the 45 minutes and cover as much distance as you can. If you go off too fast and your heart rate goes too high, you're going to have to slow right up. That
Let me give them an example.
Go for it.
So in August 2022, I managed 6K run in 39 minutes, for example. We can now do a 9K in 45 minutes. That's the improvement in a year and a half, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that just gives you an indication of the difference that I never thought I'd do. I think we could do a sub 50 minute 10K, even though we'll be dying at the end, I'm not saying that.
Yeah.
And in fact, I'm not doing it anytime soon.
See what my prediction says.
We've both got Garmin Forerunners. Let us know.
Hold on, my 10K prediction is 46:22. Okay. That'd be going. Yeah. If my watch says I can do it, I can do it.
46:22.
That might be a bit of a push. I know some people are going to be going, well, that isn't very quick. It's quick for us. And it's quick from where we started. And that's what these videos are all about. What does yours say?
As if I'm going to go 46 minute 40. Yours is 22 seconds. Is it? Yeah. 46:22.
That'd be a problem.
Apparently, I can do a sub 22 5K. There's no way. But anyway.
Yeah. So, doing those runs, you're doing them just below anaerobic threshold. And what that means is you're doing it at a point where your heart rate doesn't keep going up. So, you'll probably find we'll sit around maybe 161, or I do. For those runs, average about 161. So if the average is 161, it needs to be that. It's not going to be that from the very beginning, but at the end it doesn't want to be 170. The idea is that you're trying to pick up your pace, or you've got a pace where it keeps going up and up.
Yeah.
At that speed, 9 kilometers we finish it. I reckon at that speed I could do another kilometer. I don't feel I could do loads more than another kilometer. So that's probably about right for where we want to be training at. Those runs are hard.
Yeah, they're meant to be.
Yeah.
That's what I tell myself.
I keep saying, are they getting easier?
No.
There's your answer. So those runs there, these two types of runs, your long, slow runs, they should feel steady, comfortable, nice. Bit achy towards the end if when you're not used to doing the miles. Yeah. And then the threshold runs are going to feel, that was hard. Mm. And that's how it wants to feel. And a 45-minute threshold, I think, is a good one for Hyrox.
Don't hit the red zone, though. That we get heart rate monitor. I never thought I'd do heart rate training, because that'll help.
But then everybody's heart rate will be slightly different. Same with zones on heart rates. You can't really follow them. That's why the torque test for zone two is good, rather than looking at your watch and going, oh, my watch says I'm in zone three. Yeah, according to whichever watch you're using and however many systems they use for the zone of training.
Yeah.
So there's loads we can talk about.
I've got Woof, and that tells me something completely different. So different Woof, Garmin is different.
That's why the torque test is great for that one. So you've got the runner anaerobic threshold. As I say, it's the bit just where you can keep maintaining. And that power anaerobic threshold is the number one indicator of race performance. So that's a good one to use as a little tester as well. So that's why I like to say, record your distance, record your heart rate, your average heart rate. And then you can look back in 4 weeks, 8 weeks, 12 weeks, a year, and see the differences that you're making with that power anaerobic threshold. And then number three, your favorite.
VO2 max.
So with VO2 max, you're going to work for around anywhere between 3 and 8 minutes where you're working at the hardest you possibly can.
That's horrendous.
So if we're doing the runs, we tend to do them for 4 minutes because that's going to be about a kilometre.
Horrendous. You love it still.
They're hard. By the time I've done mine, I'm there on the treadmill with my head in my hand.
Yeah, don't speak to me.
Wondering what's going on with my life.
You absolutely love it.
I don't love them. They're the ones where beforehand I'm probably thinking,
you're never showing them.
No, I don't show it.
I'm the one going on.
I can't moan beforehand going, this session's going to be really hard.
I don't like it. We don't speak to
them. I'm telling myself that. They're the sessions when you're pushing yourself for, let's just say, 4 minutes, you then have around 4 minutes recovery. You're going to need that recovery to do it again. If you can do that same run after a minute, I'm going to guess you didn't push yourself quite hard enough on the actual run. How it should feel when you're doing it for 4 minutes. The first minute, you should be thinking, I can, this is not too bad.
Yeah.
By minute three, you should be thinking, oh,
how am I going to
get through this last minute? And then you get through the last minute and you go, I couldn't really have run anymore.
And then you think you get a 4 minute rest and you think, oh, that's loads of time. It's not.
No. If you're doing it on the rower or the ski erg, you could do this for 3 minutes. It needs to be something where you can generate power for the time you're doing it for. So if I was to do it on the rower at the moment for 8 minutes, I'm not going to get what I want from it. I'm not a good enough rower.
No,
running is good. Another way to do the VO2 max ones is to do them where you're going up a hill.
Oh, yeah.
Because then you have to go slower. You're not pounding as much with as fast the runs.
Yeah.
And again, this is the other thing to really take into account. What is your body capable of doing and what you are capable of doing with your training to how you incorporate all of this into your training and what can you recover from? If you're used to doing loads of running, you're going to be able to add quite a bit in. Normally, you're only going to add in, 20% of your training roughly should come from stuff where it's high energy, like the run at threshold run or VO2 max run. The rest is made up of steadier stuff. For me, I'm trying to build my steadier stuff running up. So the most that is in any of the programs that I do is about 50 kilometers. I mean, that's the most in a week. It builds up to 50 kilometers. My goal is to build mine up to 100 kilometers a week. But that's 100 kilometers of slow running, and that's going to take me quite a while because I don't want to get injured doing it.
Well, he'll show you then. Put your money where your mouth is. Can't wait to see these 100Ks a week.
They're coming.
Because you've got time to do it.
I've got time. I make time to do it.
Yeah, yeah.
I prioritise time to do it. But at the moment, I'm adding in more zone 2 training, but doing it on the bike. So I'm not adding in loads of running all in one go.
Yeah, I can't.
Because I would just get injured. I'd get injured straight away if I just built up that quick. So
yeah.
At the moment, it's adding in the bike
and
then switching over the bike a bit to a bit more running. Doing some of the runs on the treadmills as well, because we've got the
bouncy ones.
They're like hex ones, bouncy treadmills.
I think he's going to just copy what I said.
Hex treadmills, where it's like running on a track a bit. So if you are going to start building your running up, if you're doing it all on concrete outside of the pavement, it does take a bit of a pounding on you. So that's why you see a lot of people doing trail runs or track runs and things like that.
Yeah, I was just going to say, if you're new to running completely, I would start off by doing slower runs, longer runs, and then once you get used to that, then incorporate your faster runs. Don't do it all in one week.
It's like a triangle for your fitness and your aerobic fitness. At the bottom, it's your aerobic base. At the top is your VO2 max. You don't want a triangle like that, where you've got a real high VO2 max and no aerobic base, but you also don't want a massive aerobic base and then no tip at the top. You want a big aerobic base that's out of the sides as well, and that is when you're gonna be at your fittest. So to summarize, three things, long, slower runs, threshold runs, VO2 max, training.
That's
the running.
That's the end. Oh my God. Keep watching next videos.